Morning, everyone. Good to see everyone. I do have an announcement to make before the service starts. Is that it's a little different service today. Guest Catherine was exposed to somebody who tested positive on Friday for COVID virus. And but for safety's sake, to stay at home this weekend and quarantine. But Pastor Catherine's going to be doing her sermon from Zoom. And people in the sanctuary will be listening to it, kind of like listening to it on the radio, which I think is a really neat idea. With that, please read the personal meditation as Linda does our prayer list.
Good morning. It's great to be here today. And, you know, Jen and I have always loved being up here in Sussex County in northwestern New Jersey. And with the track of Henri the way it is, we're even more blessed to be in western New Jersey. So thank God for that. Again, welcome. And at this point in time, I'd like to have our choir come up for the intro. This back and forth, so hopefully all of us can hear everybody during the course of our service today. Please join me in our call to worship. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs, indeed it faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh sing for joy to the living God. Happy are those whose strength is in you, in whose heart are the highways to Zion. For the day in your courts is better than 1,000 elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than live in the tents of wickedness. For the Lord God is sun and shield. God bestows favor and honor. No good thing does the Lord withhold from those who walk uprightly. O Lord of hosts, happy is everyone who trusts in you. Let us worship God. Our first hymn this morning is Morning Has Broken, and it's verses 1 and 3. Morning has broken like the first morning. Praise for the singing like the first bird. Praise for the singing. Praise for the morning. Praise for them screaming. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, mine is the light, it is so plain. Praise with elation, every morning, God recreates. The proof of God's amazing love is this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Because we have faith in him, we dare to approach God with confidence. Let us join together in our prayer of confession, first in unison and then in the silence of our hearts. Merciful God, in our gracious presence, we confess our sin and the sin of this world. Although Christ is among us as our peace, we are a people divided among ourselves as we cling to the value of a broken world. The profit and pleasures we pursue lay waste the land and pollute the seas. The fears and jealousies that we harbor set neighbor against neighbor and nation against nation. We abuse your good gifts of imagination and freedom, of intellect and reason. We have turned them into bonds of oppression. Lord, have mercy upon us, heal and forgive us. Set us free to serve you in the world as agents of your reconciling love in Jesus Christ.
Now I learned. Thank you. Friends, the truth of the gospel is this: anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life is gone, and a new life has begun. Know that you are loved and forgiven, and be at peace. Thanks be to God. Amen. The peace of Jesus Christ gives us joy, gratitude, and hope. And when you have joy and gratitude and hope, you can't help but try to share that with others. Let us share the peace of Christ amongst us, and by therefore we can share it amongst people outside sanctuary. Peace of Christ be with you.
Peace. guitar anthem this morning is the segment where he has to sing toward the latter part of the song. Holy, holy, Lord God Almighty. You'll see that in the bulletin. If Charlie's on Zoom today, I don't know if he is. Is Charlie on?
I don't see.
Okay, well, if he is, I want to be able to hear Charlie singing through the Zoom. So
I don't think so.
Okay, well, get that message to him if you can.
So everybody, please join us in the middle of the anthem when we sing Holy, Holy, Holy. Ready?
Blessed Trinity,
Whew, that's a workout, I tell you. Prayer for illumination. Please join me. Lord of all, we pray that you grant your wisdom so that we can hear and learn from your word in a new way this week. May this time of scripture open our eyes, minds, and hearts to your presence and among us today and every day. Amen. The first reading this morning is from Proverbs verses 20 to 33. Wisdom cries out in the street, in the square she raises her voice. At the busiest corner she cries out, at the entrance of the city gates she speaks. How long, O simple ones, will you love being simple? How long will scoffers delight in their scoffing and fools hate knowledge? Give heed to my reproof. I will pour out my thoughts to you. I will make my words known to you, because I have called and you have refused and have stretched out my hand and no one heeded, and because you have ignored all my counsel and would have none of my reproof. I will also laugh at your calamity. I will mock when panic strikes you, when panic strikes you like a storm and your calamity comes like a whirlwind, when distress and anguish come upon you. Then they will call upon me, but I will not answer. They will seek me diligently, but will not find me. Because they hated knowledge and did not choose the fear of the Lord, would have none of my counsel and despised all my reproof. Therefore, they shall eat the fruit of their way and be sated with their own devices. For waywardness kills the simple, and the complacency of fools destroys them. But those who listen to me will be secure and will live at ease without the dread of disaster. The word of the Lord.
Our second reading today comes from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 16, verses 11 through 15, and then skipping to verse 40. The author of Acts is Luke, the same person who wrote the Gospel of Luke. The "we" in this passage means, at least, Luke, Paul, and Silas. This story of the beginnings of the church in Philippi is during Paul's second missionary journey, which is also his first trip to Europe. Let us listen now to what the Spirit is saying to us as the church today. We set sail from Troas and took a straight course to Samothrace, and the following day to Neapolis, and from there to Philippi, which is a leading city of the district of Macedonia and a Roman colony. We remained in this city for some days. On the Sabbath day, we went outside the gate by the river, where we supposed there was a place of prayer. And we sat down and spoke to the women who had gathered there. A certain woman named Lydia, a worshiper of God, was listening to us. She was from the city of Thyatira and a dealer in purple cloth. The Lord opened her heart to listen eagerly to what was said by Paul. When she and her household were baptized, she urged us, saying, "If you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come and stay at my home." And she prevailed upon us. After leaving the prison, Paul and Silas went to Lydia's home, and when they had seen and encouraged the brothers and sisters there, they departed. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please join me in prayer. Loving and wise God, help us to seek you in all we do. May we be wise in following your path for us today and every day. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be pleasing and acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Before I get started, I just wanted to say thank you to all of you for being so flexible. If COVID has taught us anything, it's that flexibility is a needed tool in ministry. So I just wanted to say thank you for being flexible today. So now, with that said and my thanks, let us go into the sermon. Now, I've always wanted to be seen as wise. What this means has changed for me over time, but it's definitely a feature I've wanted to have my entire life. I'm not sure where or how it began, but isn't that often the way? There are things about us that are so ingrained that we're not sure how they became part of us. I definitely know I wanted attention from a young age. I was in my first musical when I was barely 5 years old, and I loved it. So when my sister was born right before the start of my kindergarten year, at first I was so excited to have a baby sister. And then after a couple of weeks, it dawned on me that I didn't have all the adult attention anymore. And I realized my life would never be the same. Then as I went into elementary school, I was hit with the challenge of learning how to read and just not getting it. I would try so hard and just miss the mark week after week. I remember seeing commercials for Hooked on Phonics on TV and wanting that little kit so badly, wanting it more than anything I had ever wanted before because I was having such difficulty reading. I did eventually successfully learn how to read, and once that happened, I loved it. Though spelling was never and is not my strong suit. In fact, I remember struggling through spelling tests and being worried about what my parents might say when I didn't get a good grade on those weekly tests. For me, as a child, being wise meant being smart. And by being smart meant that I got attention. And when you're fighting for attention, you latch onto the thing that you first recognize as getting you that attention you crave. Or at least I should say, and I can say, that I did this completely. As I've gotten older, I've left behind the notion that being wise is being smart. Now I know that isn't always the case. There are lots of people who are incredibly intelligent and not very wise in a whole host of ways. And there are people who aren't academically smart, but are wise beyond their years. To this day, I'm not very wise when it comes to lots of things, like anything mechanical, right? Cars, machinery, or plumbing, as a few examples. Whenever these things break, I call a professional to take over. And I'm sure you can relate to what I'm saying. We all have things we really know about and things we don't. We know where we're wise and where we're not. In the Bible, when it comes to wisdom, This is both a personality trait people have and a category of books within the Bible. The Jewish scriptures have a whole collection of books called the wisdom books, and these include Job, Proverbs, and Ecclesiastes. These wisdom books come from a tradition of wisdom teaching that was all over the ancient Near East. Our wisdom books in the Bible didn't come from a vacuum, though they are different than other wisdom thoughts from the surrounding areas. So what do they do? Well, the wisdom books gather around sayings and teachings that look at moral behavior and God. The classic example is the book of Proverbs. An interesting thing about Proverbs is that, yes, it's filled with pithy sayings that try to inspire us to live a certain way. But that's not all. Proverbs also has a few chapters at the beginning of the book that tell a story of a father passing on important key pieces of education to his son. The reading we did from Proverbs today about the personified Lady Wisdom comes from the early section of this book. In the Women's Bible Commentary, Reverend Dr. Christine Roy Yoder describes this metaphorical woman of the Bible in this way. Wisdom personified as a woman is breathtakingly complex. She speaks as God or a prophet, taking her stand in the busiest places of the city, in the thick of everyday bustle, and calling out to the naive, scoffers, and fools to heed her instruction, lest disaster befall them. She's a teacher who promises to reveal all that she knows, all that she is, and provide generously for those who seek her. Wisdom's authority springs from her existence prior to God's creation of the cosmos. The parent teaching his son indicates this first briefly in chapter 3, verses 19 through 20. Where wisdom is the means by which God created the world. She is woven into God's handiwork. By this view of Lady Wisdom, of wisdom being personified as a woman, we see the beauty of wisdom as creative, as part of the fabric of the world. Just as Jesus was at the beginning of creation, so is wisdom. This drive to create, support, and bring life is part of God's wisdom. The things that we may consider wise may or may not be the same kind of wise as this character of wisdom promotes. Her focus is bringing the student, the son, to understand that a wise life is a good one and is one where you follow God's guidance rather than others. And a main part of being wise is fear of the Lord. This fear of the Lord is fear in its biggest sense, not just in being afraid because of a scary or dangerous situation. It's more about knowing that God is our ultimate judge, our ultimate provider, our ultimate parent. It's a more primitive brain fear of not wanting to upset or disappoint your caregiver, and God is our foremost creator. Yes, we have our earthly parents, and we have God, the creator of the whole universe and each of us individually. And the ancient ancestors, they did understand the world in a vastly different way, right? With vengeful gods and needing to act in a certain way to placate and please the gods to not be punished. Now that's a scary fear. And Jewish people had a different understanding because they only worshiped one God. But a similar stress existed around treating God with a sense of authority and prominence in all choices. And perhaps we do well to learn from their persistence of seeking out God's guidance in our daily lives. By the time of Christ, wisdom and fear of God are still there, even if they're more behind the scenes. They're still part of the cultural understanding. And then in the verses I read from Acts, Lydia meets Paul and his team of missionaries as they come to Europe for the first time. Paul heads to Philippi because of a dream from the Holy Spirit to head to this area to preach to the Philippians. While they're in Philippi, they come across Lydia praying on the riverbank. She was a convert to Judaism, or at least she was practicing Judaism. Philippi didn't have a synagogue because they didn't have enough Jewish men, which is 10, to constitute a synagogue. So they went to a different holy place to pray. They went to the river. And Lydia becomes one of the first Christians, not only from this group, but in all of Europe. And she invites Paul and his troop to come stay at her house. That's where Paul, Silas, and Luke remain until Paul and Silas leave the city after being arrested and then released. Lydia is one wise woman. She recognizes the true God of the whole world, even while being a Roman citizen and not being Jewish by birth. She's wise in living after God's desire by celebrating the Sabbath, by attending this time of prayer at the riverbed. She's wise by hosting the earliest leaders of the church as they spread the good news of Jesus Christ, which is at odds with Roman society at the time. She was wise to trust in their message, and in most importantly, to trust in God's faithfulness to her through her acting out her faith in this radically hospitable way. Lydia had the unique perspective of being a woman of means. We don't hear of a husband or children. Instead, we hear of her business, selling purple cloth, and her household, which could mean her servants. This makes her quite different from most other women of her day. She's a businesswoman, and she's very wise in her trade. Making purple cloth is an expensive endeavor and a profitable one if done well. We walk into a store today, right, and have clothes or fabrics of all colors and patterns and styles, whatever we can want or imagine. But that wasn't the case in the early first century. And making colorful cloth added a level of skill and difficulty because all the dyes came from natural material, mostly from bugs or plants. I know that people do use these techniques today, especially with food scraps, but it's much rarer, right? But in the ancient world, making and selling colorful cloth was quite the business because that was the only way to take clothes from the color of a sheep's wool to any other color. And the purple cloth itself was incredibly valuable because you only got purple from a specific kind of snail. This process wasn't easy and wasn't quick, which is why it was expensive and in demand for those of the upper classes. Lydia was a wise woman who worshiped the one true God and had business smarts. I'm always intrigued by the named women in the Bible. And Acts and the letters in the New Testament are full of named women, which goes to show how open the early church was to women's leadership. our female deacons, elders, and pastors all draw our lineage to women like Lydia, who were imperative leaders in their local church community. Lydia used her gifts and her situation to work on God's behalf. She was able to be hospitable to the apostles and then house the church from her home. She welcomed in the church in Philippi and therefore in Europe. Her way of being is an inspiration and one that wisdom personified in Proverbs would applaud. Using her skills and talents to live out her calling from God to spread the good news of Jesus Christ. A wise use of her skills. We can most definitely learn from Lydia. With her wise use of her situation in life and her support of this growing baby church movement. Just as we can learn from Rachel and Leah of the importance of trusting in God above all else. And how Rahab showed us how serving others is serving God. What a foundational piece of living out our faith that is. And with Hannah's story, we saw her loyalty to God helped her to face the negative and hard situations in her life. In Bathsheba's story, we caught a glimpse of strength in and through dark moments that lead to places and spaces of happiness and fulfillment. And last week, as we looked at Esther, we used her story to explain how boldness is a factor in our faith. When we bring together the stories of these women from the Old Testament, as well as many women's stories from the New Testament, we can see the ways God works through all of us in similar ways. These women are an inspiration. And I think Lady Wisdom would be overjoyed that we spent time this summer exploring the ways we can grow and be inspired by all these stories. Friends, reread the stories of the women in this series. Spend time looking into gaining wisdom from their challenges and from their accomplishments. Our role models come from real life. And this ancient book is full of wisdom and tells the story of God's love for you individually and the whole world as a whole. Listen for how the Holy Spirit is guiding you to follow God's voice in every part of your life. It may be subtle and at times hard to discern, but that's why we have scripture and one another. Just as Lydia listened to Paul and then supported those first believers in Philippi. So friends, go and be wise. Amen. And friends, now please stand as you are able, in body or in spirit, and join together in our next hymn, number 370, Just As I Am Without One Plea, verses 1, 3, and 4.
Thank you.
Let's remain standing and boldly proclaim what we believe in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven, and he sits on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the union of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
It's this time in our service where we share our joys and concerns, and we respond with, God of mercy, hear our prayer. Let us start with the congregation in church first. Are there any joys or concerns that you'd like to present at this time? Chuck.
Yeah, a friend of ours, her husband, just the last few days, that was hospice.
John Gibbs and wife Becky. John was placed in hospice at this particular time. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Janet?
It's a joy to have the choir back. It's beautiful. And I guess both reminded me that this past week was our anniversary. He said happy anniversary. Rich and I are married 3 9.
Yeah. And it's been wonderful. I had it written down here. No. The other joy, I just got to share this. It's going to take a minute or so, but anyway, when I was born, and when we lived in Clifton, there were four of us, three Riches and a Bob, who kind of hung out together all the time. So the Riches were called, I was Hayes, there was Hemp, and there was Pipe for Rich Pipeling, Hemp for Hempel, and Bob. When we moved up here, it was like moving to another planet, so we kind of lost touch to a certain degree with our cohesiveness. And then in 88, Hemp moved out to Atlanta, and then there was Pipe and Bob left. Well, about 10 years ago or so, may rest in peace, Pipe passed away. And so, and then a few years later, Bob. So, I was wondering, well, gee, whatever happened to Hemp? So I could never find them. So we were down at Rich's house the other day, and he said, hey, Dad, I know you've been looking for Hempel. And for whatever reason, I was searching, and what popped up on Rich Pipeling's obituary, actually, was, and I don't know how he got there, was the phone number for Hemp. So I reached out to him the other day. I said, hey, Hemp, how you doing? He had to stop and think, because nobody had called him Hemp since he moved in 1988, so like for 33 years, he didn't even know who it was. So I said, it's Rich, hey, it's Hayes. So he said, hey, so we started to talk for a few minutes, and I said, let's catch up. We were in the car going to the shore. So he gets back to me, and we Zoomed yesterday for about an hour. And I tell you, it was really great. Janet and I had the opportunity to see him, and we caught up on 33 years of not seeing each other, and we're now going to stay connected. So obviously that's a joy that we really had yesterday. It was kind of a neat thing. So Zoom brought us together. So God of mercy, hear our prayer.
It was too late to reach out.
Oh yeah, it was super. Any others? Yes, Chris.
It was a joy this month to have my father and Jody here. It was nice after not seeing them for 2 years. It was a special time. They are visiting with someone today, or they would be here, but they're leaving Friday. So I know someone could reach out and, visited with them and everything, that meant a lot to them.
And you could tell them that you walked in after we sang it, but I had, when we sang Holy, 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 were you here for that or not? I'm not sure. But anyway, I said, I hope Charlie's here, because I want to hear him bang that out, because the rafters will shake. So express that to him when you get a chance to. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Yes. Okay. That's for Sheila's father-in-law, and he's at Barn Hill. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Over to Zoom. Is there anyone on Zoom who has a joy or concern? Okay.
Great. Are we ready for me to do the prayer?
Okay.
Yes. Okay. So please join your hearts with mine in prayer this morning. Let us pray. God of wonder and joy, we thank you for this time of worship together today, for connecting us through all kinds of ways to bring us together to worship your Son in so many places. Help us, God, to live our lives as worship for your holy name. We thank you for your many, many blessings, including the joy of having the choir sing again today, for very exciting anniversaries this past week, so many decades of love and growth spent together for Janet and Rich. And we also thank you for internet sleuthing and being able to find friends who you haven't spoken to in over 30 years, and for Zoom being able to see each other face to face, even in the midst of a pandemic. So we thank you, God, for Rich's ability to see another Rich yesterday. Immortal God, we lay before you the concerns of our hearts. For folks impacted by the many different terrible situations right now. COVID-19, the Taliban's capture of Afghanistan, the wildfires, floods, earthquakes, and hurricanes around the world. We also pray for those we know personally and the concerns you've placed on our hearts, including the Gibbs family with John Gibbs being on hospice. We pray for his wife as she continues to be with him at the end of his life and then through the grief when that comes. We pray for traveling mercies for Charlie and Dodie as they go back to Florida. We thank you, God, for bringing them safely here, and we know you'll bring them safely back, but we do pray for that. We also pray, oh God, for Robert, as he is still in rehab. We pray that his healing continues from his falls several weeks ago. We pray for him and his family as they continue to prepare for him to come home, whenever that may be. Guide us, oh God, in all of these needs. Help us to see how we can be the helpers. Sovereign God, we live in an interconnected world, and we pray for your whole church within it. May we all be united in your love for us and in our love for you. May we seek first your kingdom by treating one another with compassion and openness. Help us, O God, to be wise in following you above all else. Divine parent, you are our loving parent and true guide in life. You created us and all that is in this world. We pray that all of humanity take steps to lessen our environmental impact and strive to take care of this planet you created and gave us stewardship of. Help us, O God, to live more like your image. O Holy Spirit, we pray that your voice be loud and clear for all of our leaders, locally, nationally, and internationally. May they choose to follow your guidance and strive for all people to be treated fairly and justly. Help us all, O God, to not let any prejudices get in our way from seeing all people as made in your image and as a reflection of your love. Mighty God, it's in you that we find our strength each and every day. It's in you that this church community finds our meaning and our purpose. We pray that we receive the wisdom from you, your word, your spirit, and your community to be the light on the hill for all people. May we proclaim your love and your grace with every word we say and with every action we take. We thank you, O God, for the ways we can see your hand at work in our lives, from the most complex to the simplest of ways. We thank you for the ways you provide for us, including through Jesus Christ, giving us a prayer, which we now say together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
As we celebrate the ways God is active in our lives today, just as God was active in the lives of the women in the Bible all the way back to the beginning of God's special relationship with humanity, we offer back to God a portion of what we've been given. Please give joyously with God's kingdom here on earth in mind. Remind us to, whether we're sending in our offerings by mail or online or put it in the plates, that we also do it joyously with our doxology. Please stand. Join with our unison prayer of dedication. God of abundance, you bless us beyond what we can imagine. Help us be bold givers, giving of ourselves our thanksgiving for the life-giving gift of Jesus Christ. Use these gifts and offerings to bless this church family and the wider community around us. In Christ's name, we lay our offerings at your throne. Amen. Please be seated. Remind everyone to look through the bulletin and the insert. As you see, also during the week when you get your email, folks on Zoom, when you get your email with the link to the church news from there, anything that needs to be highlighted or somebody wants to make an additional announcement? Walter?
It seems like the last couple weeks I've had a few announcements. The first is that we have our first show at the Theater Library, and we have an absolutely splendid show and a splendid number of people there to see it, so it's very gratifying. We have another show, John Sheehan, coming up this Thursday. The show starts at 6:30. We get the weather, which we did last week. And then I have another announcement, rather than dates, and so I'll just ask you to keep an eye out for it. But there's a traveling wall of remembrance, which is a model of the wall that's erected to remember the veterans of Vietnam, people who died there. So when you travels all over the United States, sometime in the next couple of weeks, if there are something, it's going to be at Woodbury Park.
I saw that on TV the other day. Okay. Yeah, that's really impressive to get that up here. I just wanted to mention, Jen and I went to a book fair at the Methodist Church the other day. But anyway,
$5 for a big bag of books. So now, you know, that's my present for next year. No. But it just meant to let you know, today it's free. So you could go over there and get books for free. It's like a garage sale. It's over and you put it out of curve. Well, everything's there for free. So if you're really getting some good books, there are a lot of them there. Just want to let you know.
Coming up this week, I guess we'll go either management on Zoom or message for Zoom or
Catherine has one.
You're on.
Just a reminder that the Old Clove Church, the worship service is happening on September 19th at 2 p.m.
Okay, the annual service, September 19th at 2 p.m. at the Old Clove Church. I think I'm going to go to this. I've never been in there, so I think I'm going to go to this. Usually it's really hot. I'm thinking like, but I'm really interested in going this year. Looking at chronologically, well, we'll work back from next week. Next week, Walter is going to be leading the service next week. He'll be guest preacher. And I always dig seeing him what Walter has to say because he does it without reading it, like the rest of us. he remembers it all in his head kind of and just uses bullet points and stuff. He's faking it. I love it, Walter. So. And this week, looking at the Hurricane Henri, I mean, we're not going to get hit as much as the rest of the state is, but there's talk that we will have flooding and winds and some power outages possible. And then it's going to get hot again during this week. So if, you know, if anybody runs out of power or needs something from the stores or something, let's all reach out to each other and not be afraid to connect with each other and, you know, call and check in on each other or call each other for help, because I think that's what we do. And then at the same time, when we feel that, we can reach out to our friends, and that's how we share the joy and the hope and the peace and the gratitude. So with that, I'd like to go into our last hymn, God of Life, hymn 275, please stand if you're able.
friends, go out into the world being wise by using your gifts from God. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.
Thank you. That sounds great.
Catherine, I hope you have a very about you. Keep up. And our prayers next week.
Oh, thank you, Barbara.
Thank you. I hope if you have any effect, that they're very small.
Good old. Yes.
Here's hoping all the tests will be negative.
Absolutely. That's right.
Oh, and I need to stop recording.
Now you know about Lydia.
Yes.